In previous few weeks, you have learned semiconductor physics, basic operating principles of solar cells, optical phenomena, and light management techniques involved in a solar cell as well. The purpose of a solar cell is to convert energy of electromagnetic radiation directly into electricity. The energy conversion in a solar cell is based on the photovoltaic effect. Now it's time to discuss how to achieve a maximum conversion efficiency in a solar cell. Is it possible to utilize 100% of incident solar energy? Is there an upper limit of the conversion efficiency of a solar cell? What are the loss mechanisms that occur in a solar cell? To answer all these questions, this week we will focus on the loss mechanisms in a solar cell and explain some strategies how to tackle them. Let's first review the basic operating principles of a solar cell. As already mentioned, the energy conversion in a solar cell is based on the photovoltaic effect. The photovoltaic effect is described as the generation of a voltage difference at the junction of two different materials in response to visible or other radiation. The first step is the energy conversion process is the absorption of light in the absorber layer of solar cell. The result of the absorption is the generation of electron hole pairs. In the second step, the photogenerated electrons and holes must be separated from each other to prevent their recombination. When the separation occurs, the oppositely charged carriers have to be collected and saved at different parts of the solar cell. Sometimes we call these parts membranes. In this way, the photogenerated carriers become a source of electricity, and via electrodes that are attached to the membranes, they can do a useful work in an external circuit. Before we go deeper into all the loss mechanisms in a solar cell, first we will take a look at an overview of all of them. We can divide loss mechanisms into two big categories: optical losses and electrical losses. Optical losses are related to the absorption, transmission, and reflection losses of the incident light, which can be further divided into spectral mismatch losses and additional optical losses. Under spectral mismatch losses, we mean thermalization and non-absorption losses of energy of photons that propagate through the absorber of a solar cell. Additional optical losses include reflection and transmission losses, parasitic absorption in supporting layers of a solar cell, and shading losses caused by front electrodes. Electrical losses arise mainly from the recombination of charge carriers in solar cells and other electrical losses. The recombination losses are due to the loss of charge carriers by bulk and surface recombination, and by fundamental recombination that we relate to the utilization of the bandgap energy. The other electrical losses represent voltage drops at series and shunt resistances. In this video, we will first review and quantify the spectral mismatch losses in a solar cell. AM1.5 solar spectrum is used to determine the conversion efficiency of a solar cell. In this figure, you see the spectral power density of AM1.5 solar spectrum as function of the wavelength. The unit of spectral power density is watt per square meter per nanometer. The wavelength is represented in nanometers. We usually use two parameters to describe the spectral properties of incident light. The first one is already mentioned, spectral power density, often also referred to as the spectral irradiance. The second parameter is the photon flux density. Another important parameter to describe the incident power of light is irradiance. Irradiance is the total power density of incident light, and we can calculate it by integrating the spectral power density over the wavelength. As the spectral power density and the photon flux density are related via photon energy, irradiance can also be found by integrating the product of photon energy and the photon flux density over the wavelength. When measuring the conversion efficiency of solar cells, we use the AM1.5 spectrum irradiance of 1,000 watts per square meter. As you may recall, depending on the bandgap energy of the absorber layer and the energy of incident photon, three situations can occur. The energy of the incident photon is less than, equal to, or larger than the bandgap energy. A photon with energy exactly equal to the bandgap energy can be absorbed and will generate an electron-hole pair. Electron and hole will occupy an energy state at the edge of the conduction and valence band, respectively. Photons with energy smaller than the band gap cannot excite valence electrons to the states in the conduction band and will simply pass through the semiconductor material. This is the case to which we refer as non-absorption losses. On the other hand, photons with higher energy than the band gap will be absorbed and will generate electron-hole pairs. However, electron and holes tend to occupy most stable states, which are at the edges of the bands. Therefore, the photon energy that is in excess of the band gap energy will be released as heat. This process of releasing the excess energy of electrons and holes to the lattice is known as thermal relaxation or thermalization. So how to quantify the non-absorption losses? Let's take crystalline silicon solar cells as an example. The green area shown in the plot of the AM1.5 spectral power density represents the region of the spectrum that can be absorbed by a crystalline silicon solar cell. Lambda G denotes the wavelength of photons whose energy corresponds to the bandgap energy of crystalline silicon. Lambda G is approximately 1,110 nanometers. On the other hand, the spectrum highlighted in yellow represents photons that do not have enough energy to be absorbed. It is the energy of these photons that represent the non-absorption loss. First, we need to calculate the fraction of the incident power that the solar cell can absorb. We find this fraction by dividing the irradiance of photons that have enough energy to be absorbed. These are photons with wavelengths equal or smaller than lambda G by the total irradiance of the AM1.5 spectrum. After determining this fraction, the non-absorption fraction of the total irradiance is calculated by subtracting this fraction from 1. In thermalization process, the excess photon energy with respect to the bandgap is released by the excited electrons and holes as heat to the lattice. The excess energy of photons lost in thermalization in a crystalline silicon solar cell is indicated by the red arrow. It is the yellow area of the spectrum above the brown one. Since the electrons and holes tend to occupy energy levels at the bottom of the conduction band and the top of the valence band, respectively, the fraction of the absorbed energy that a solar cell can deliver as useful energy is equal to the band gap of the absorber layer. To calculate the fraction of solar irradiance that can be delivered as useful energy, we first calculate the power of all photons that can be absorbed related to the bandgap of crystalline silicon absorber and divide it with the total irradiance of these photons. It is the brown area in the plot that represents the fraction of AM1.5 spectrum that can be delivered as useful energy by crystalline silicon solar cells. From this equation, we can conclude that only the energy of photons corresponding to the bandgap of the absorber is fully utilized. By combining the fraction of incident power absorbed by a solar cell with the fraction of the power that a solar cell can deliver as useful energy, we determine the so-called ultimate conversion efficiency for a solar cell with a single absorber. The figure on the left shows the ultimate conversion efficiency as a function of the bandgap energy for different spectra. The green line is for the AM1.5 spectrum. The blue line is for the AM0 spectrum, and the red line is for the radiation spectrum of a black body at 6000 Kelvin. We see from the green line that the maximum ultimate efficiency is around 48% for a solar cell with the absorber that has a bandgap of 1.2 electron volts. In this video, we have reviewed how the bandgap of a solar cell absorber limits the utilization of radiation with broad spectrum of energies. The mismatch between the bandgap energy of the solar cell absorber and the broad spectrum of photon energies is the most fundamental loss limiting the conversion efficiency of a solar cell. In the following lectures, we will go through other loss mechanisms that further decrease the theoretical maximal conversion efficiency.